The Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all the things that had happened. And while they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" And he asked them, "What things?" And they replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, now it's the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some of the women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it was just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself and all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on, but they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us when he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. And they were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed. He has appeared to Simon." Then they told what happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
You may be seated. How's my sound? You okay in the back? All right, good. I always like to ask when I have a new setup, because, you know, one Sunday I was doing this, and suddenly a guy in the back jumped up and said, "I can't hear a word you're saying." And the person sitting right there just got up and said, "I can hear everything fine, let's switch." So it's always worth checking. Much of Luke's gospel is spent traveling. The center of this gospel is a story about Jesus and the disciples walking to Jerusalem, and it lasts 10 chapters in Luke's gospel, this journey together. Now, this story, there are two disciples traveling, and they're going in the opposite direction. They're leaving Jerusalem behind them. They're leaving in despair, and they are despondent. And they're fearful because of what happened to Jesus could happen to them. Now, the rest of the disciples are hiding somewhere in an upper room, but the two of them are beaten a path out of town on the road. They're walking along, talking with one another. And then in verse 21 are probably the saddest words in the Bible. "But we had hoped he was the one." but we had hoped. Hope lost. The incredible hope that they had about Jesus being the Messiah had been crushed. And Jesus' followers are hiding and fleeing, perhaps looking to return to their previous life. But we had hoped. We know this feeling, don't we? The hope for a healing that didn't come. The hope for a restoration in a broken relationship, but it wasn't healed. A hope for a breaking of a new dawn in a darkness, but the darkness prevails. And even the spirit in our country right now, our national mood, regardless of kind of where you are politically, for too many of our citizens, a different reality exists. Mothers and children trapped in poverty in our inner cities, rusted out factories scattered like tombstones across the landscape of our nation, an educational system flush with cash, believes our young, beautiful students provided deprived of all knowledge, and crime and gangs and drugs have stolen too many lives and robbed our country of so much unrealized potential. We are one nation, and their pain is our pain. Those are not my words. Those are the words of President Trump describing what he calls the mess when he gave his inaugural address 2 years ago. The next day, after he spoke those words, thousands of people gathered on the mall of our nation to protest and resist the changes he wanted, and even the language he uses. And for my family, my daughter-in-law comes from a predominantly Muslim country. And she lives in fear that she will be separated from her children when she comes to visit this country, even though she has a green card. She's called to work at the United Nations, but every time she comes, she's fearful. She works on nuclear disarmament, which blessed are the peacemakers, if we actually let them come into the country. We are afraid as a family. Our children are afraid in their schools, afraid that they might be shot. It seems there is a spirit of fear in our nation, regardless of your political opinions. People actually talk about what the disciples were doing in this story, fleeing. There are people fleeing Central America to come here because of violence and drought. Meanwhile, according to a Gallup poll, 30% of young people in this country under the age of 30 want to flee the United States and move to another country. You see, fear leads to flight. And that's what these two disciples are doing. They're fleeing in fear. And they say, but we had hoped. And then a stranger walks with them, and he speaks about the scriptures and how God's word speaks to them in the face of what the reality is for them, and how God's word helps to clarify the very things that they've been struggling with. And at the end of the journey, they ask this stranger to stay with them, that he would abide with them. So they sit down at a meal together, and on this Sunday evening, they eat a meal, and the stranger has taken the bread, and he blesses it, and he breaks it, and he gives it to them, and then they saw. They saw the presence of Jesus, the resurrected Lord. And the very act that he had done when he fed the 5,000 and he blessed the bread and he broke it, the very act that he did in that final meal with his disciples when he blessed the bread and broke it, they saw it. They saw Jesus. And then he was gone from their sight. And they jumped back up and they turned around and they went back to Jerusalem. They turned around. And you know the Greek word right here? Metanoia. It's the word that we often translate as repentance, but it really means turning around, changing their life. They had seen the resurrected Savior, the very thing that they were running away from, their thing that they feared, the threat of danger. They chose in the dark to go back into that very place. They ran back into the danger in Jerusalem. Why? Because they had the good news that Jesus is risen. Yeah. Death is not final. Evil will not prevail. God was doing a new thing. The darkness had been overcome by the light of Christ shining into the world. And what about us? If only we could have this experience. If only we could have God's word speak to us in a powerful way. If we could only gather around a table for a meal in the presence of Christ. If we could be propelled to proclaim to a broken and darkened world that God is about a new thing. That if we could gather together on the first day of the week and have an experience where we meet the resurrected Christ, then we could run for joy and tell the world that sin and evil and death will not prevail. And we do. That's precisely what we're doing here today. It's what we do every Sunday when we gather in our worshiping communities. We meet Jesus in the proclamation of God's word and in the breaking of the bread. And then we are sent out into the world. Paul, that is what you are being ordained to do today. There will be many things placed upon you. Budget meetings. Knowing how to set the thermostat in the church. Knowing how to hit the reset button on the furnace. Parochial reports. And of course, your annual report to the bishop, which is essential. But that's not why we are ordaining you today. It is so that you can bring light to the darkness of the world, to sit with those who suffer, to sit with those who have lost hope, to sit with those who want to flee in fear. And what do you have to offer them? You have a ministry of word and sacrament. You will bring the good news of Jesus Christ in their midst, that the reign of God is here and now, the good news into the darkness. You will bring to them the presence of the resurrected Jesus in bread and wine and water. And that's not the only thing you need. You need to call God's to repentance, to metanoia, to turn around, not to flee, but to be sent out into the world, to run back into the dark places, because God, through Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit, will prevail, to witness to the resurrected Christ, who is here among us. God is doing a new thing, and the resurrected Christ is still among us now. And you will have the joy of bringing Christ's presence presence into the lives of people at their birth, teaching young people confirmation, forming faith for people at every age, at marriage, in illness, and even at the moment of their death. You will be bringing the light of Christ into these places. And you will meet the resurrected Jesus. Often in the most unlikely places, in the face of a stranger, in the face of a woman accepting food at the food pantry, in a gracious act of kindness given to you, on a desolate beach, in a prayer that is said to strengthen you. These meetings will be accidental and unexpected. But I know this because I have met Jesus in all of those places. And then each and every week, you will experience the presence of the resurrected Christ when you proclaim God's word and when you take and bless and break the bread and share it. For Christ has promised to be there in the breaking of the bread. And will everything come out beautifully for you? For the lives of your people? The lives of people in our nation? No. There will still be brokenness and evil in the world, and shiny things will distract us. Squirrel! But we are called to speak on behalf and to care for the poor, the lost, the lonely, the refugee, the suffering, and those who are oppressed. But we are not the people who had hope and are fleeing. We are the people who are traveling the road with the resurrected Jesus, running back with joy, knowing that darkness and evil and death will ultimately be defeated. There will be days when it seems like the darkness is winning and that we are not enough. And on those days, I recommend turning to Luther's Small Catechism and reading these words. I believe that by my own understanding or strength, I cannot believe in Jesus Christ, my Lord, or come to him, but instead the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel and enlightened me with his gifts and made me holy, kept me in the true faith, just as he calls and gathers and enlightens and makes holy the whole Christian church on earth and keeps it with Jesus Christ in one common and true faith. Daily in this Christian church, the Holy Spirit abundantly forgives all sins, mine and those of all the believers. And on the last day, the Holy Spirit will raise me and all the dead and will give to me, all the believers in Christ, eternal life. This is most certainly true. Our faith, our strength comes not from us, but from the Holy Spirit. So we can, with the guidance and the power of the Holy Spirit, turn and travel that road with Jesus where he has called us. And we will meet the resurrected Jesus. Thanks be to God. Amen.